even if there was
a sectarian Jewish teacher living in Palestine during the first part of this first century called Joshua or Jesus, he had nothing at all to do with the crucified Christos of Paul's theology. Thus had no part to play in the formation of that distinctive amalgam of faiths that eventually swept the world. I believe that the innocent collection of tales and sayings, which was apparently allowed to pass freely among the beleaguered selves of believers, in hourly danger of discovery and execution, was but a cover story. We are dealing with myth, not history. Was a Jewish messianic pretender named Joshua or Jesus, who was crucified at the instigation of his fellow countrymen in the procuratorship of Pontius Pilate, we shall probably never know. It hardly matters. The inner councils of the church were aware of secret writings which were not to be promulgated even among the faithful. As the second century church father Clement of Alexandria said, not everything that is true needs necessarily to be divulged to all men.
It's no secret that Christmas parties and New Year's parties promote inebriation with the celebration, or at very least, a toast. Inebriation is part of the most traditional celebrations, and it may not surprise you to learn that the combination of inebriation and celebration dates back to our tribal ancestors. What may surprise you, however, is the fact that modern-day religion also has direct ties to ritualistic inebriation. These rituals and celebrations throughout antiquity were often annual events, and these annual events were marked by particular celestial alignments.
Plants and humans have shared this planet together for millions of years. Plants have been our never-ending source of food, and clothing, and shelter. And each day, as we see the sunrise, we know that the sun sustains our life, and it sustains the lives of our plant allies. However, this magnificent story of the yearly cycle of the sun, and the cycles of the moon, and the stars, and the plants, have become hidden. These stories have been suppressed for so long that they've become mythology. And there is another extremely important human-plant relationship that has been overlooked for so long that it's become taboo. We've laid claim to the term inebriology, which up until now has been this fictitious field of study and a term used by drunken college students, but we couldn't think of a better word to describe a study pertaining to the symbolism and the history of ritualistic and celebratory inebriation. This involves an in-depth study of shamanism and the sacred plants themselves. Plants, mushrooms, and various plant combinations have traditionally been used by the shaman, or the medicine man, for many millennia for healing, for extremely deep levels of meditation, and in their ceremonies, in their rituals, and rites of passage as well. All of it hidden in language, artwork, myth, and tradition. And a focus on this artwork, myth, and tradition will guide us on our journey through the ancient mysteries, combining the understanding of plant knowledge with celestial knowledge.
The older medieval cathedrals were often called mystery schools, and the mystery schools were primarily used for religious, mystical, and even scientific study. However, there were no congregations. They were not open to the public. Mystery schools were structured similar to the way Freemasons structure their teachings. One enters as an initiate, much like a fraternity, and was often sworn to secrecy. In fact, we still have fraternities and sororities that stem from these ancient mystery schools. Modern education's 12 grades and mortar boards stem from this ancient knowledge.
In my recent books, in particular The Sacred Mushroom and the Cross, The Dead Sea Scrolls and the Christian Myth, and The Forthcoming Physician Heal Thyself, I try to demonstrate something of the multi-layered structure of the gospel narratives and teachings. Their decipherment is difficult, and was intended to be so. Just as the Essene secrets were not for the eyes of the uninitiated. Even their written works were wrapped up and hidden in caves, or in the final emergency, simply wrenched apart and thrown into a secret underground chamber. Their most vital mysteries were never committed to writing, as Josephus makes clear, but passed only by word of mouth under awful oaths of silence.
These mystery schools would instruct their members by way of elaborate dramas, using a play or a metaphor as a method of initiation and education. So let's begin with one of the oldest teachings to ever emerge from the mystery schools, on earth as it is in heaven. And another way of making the statement is to say, as above, so below. It's an acknowledgement of the polar opposites, light and dark, good and evil. This is yin and yang, the macrocosm and the microcosm. And philosophy, alchemy, and many other ancient teachings speak of this macrocosm and microcosm. That which is above is also below. And this relationship of polar opposites is one of the most essential and the most overlooked elements in understanding ancient philosophy and religion. The greater and the lesser. The positive and the negative. Heaven and hell. The macrocosm and the microcosm. These polar opposites are in perfect balance with one another. And you can think of the macrocosm-microcosm relationship like octaves on a piano. They may vibrate at different frequencies, but they still work in harmony together.
This is a representation of the Yggdrasil tree, which portrays the concept that which is above is also below. The tree has branches and leaves above ground, and it has branching roots burrowing underground, the chthonic realm. As in the heavens, so on earth. This dualistic philosophy has been applied all throughout antiquity in religion, alchemy, and mysticism. The constellations in the sky make up the greatest story ever told, and among these constellations are the anthropomorphized gods of mythology, Gemini, Hercules, Andromeda, Cepheus, and the rest. Also in the sky are the animals, such as Aquila, Hydra, Taurus, Pisces, and so on. These aren't exactly anthropomorphisms, but rather zoomorphisms, and were also revered as gods. In fact, this is where we get the word zodiac from, as zo comes from the word zoo, zodiac.
Well, the Bible tells us that although we are mortals, we are gods as well. Consequently, this application of the zodiac signs to our bodies occurs in symbolism. On earth as it is in heaven, the temple of God is in the heavens and it dwells within us as well. Nevertheless, we create these anthropomorphisms, these gods built out of combinations of nature, celestial gods, plant gods, fertility gods, or compound gods containing many different elements. And they were all worshipped and written about as though they were living deities.
Even if there was a sectarian Jewish teacher living in Palestine during the first part of the first century, called Joshua or Jesus, he had nothing at all to do with the crucified Christos of Paul's theology, and thus had no part to play in the formation of that distinctive amalgam of faiths that eventually swept the world. As far as the gospel narratives of Jesus are concerned, we can free ourselves forever from the need to lay bare a reality on which to base a more historically convincing portrait of a first century teacher who in three short years was supposed to have founded a new religion or so transformed an existing messianic faith that it could become almost immediately acceptable to a Gentile world. We're dealing with myth, not history. The question we now have to ask is, what was the nature and purpose of that myth?
Sol Invictus is often referred to as Mithra because of their strong correlation. In fact, the Persian and Roman sun god Mithra in the Mithraic Chronos, or personification of infinite time, is in the center of the zodiac. He is surrounded by his 12 helpers, or the 12 helpers of the sun. You will often find a goddess, a sun, or some sort of divine entity inside the zodiac when depicted in art. There are even old paintings and murals of Christ sitting on a throne surrounded by his 12 helpers. Sometimes these are depicted as 12 angels, and other times the 12 disciples. We've even found some that are depicted as the 12 signs of the zodiac. The important thing to know about the deity is that the deity is merely a character. It is the character's characteristics and the physical posture that are important. The name of the character can be interchanged and applied to different cultures and ages, but the numerous characteristics have remained the same in various deities, including Christ, Krishna, Horus, Mithra, Buddha, Quetzalcoatl, and many others.
Many of these characteristics represent this star of wonder, this only begotten son of the Creator, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made. In other words, and as Jordan Maxwell likes to point out, this ball of light in the sky is not our responsibility, it's God's responsibility. It's not our sun, it's God's sun. This worshipful sun is the main star of all stars. It's the only star that is of real importance to us because it gives us our life. And likewise, in this macrocosmic personification, the sun and all other stars in the sky are kings, making Jesus and Horus and all the other sun gods the king of kings. Mythology never ended. Jesus is the newest myth, and most people are smart enough to know this fact, but so many are just too frightened to face it. The animals in my house tend to follow the warm sunlight around the house in the morning time, and these splashes of sun on the floor are in different locations at 7 a.m. in the spring versus 7 a.m. in the fall. It's the tilting of the Earth's axis that brings about these seasonal changes, and as simple of a concept as this may be, this is the gateway into some of religion's most guarded mysteries. If you film, videotape, or even take a time-lapse